When brake fluid deteriorates, you may get a condition called brake fade.
John, we sure don't want that to happen to our Silverado. It's packing a lot of power, and we need to be able to stop it.
Yeah, you know, brake fluid's hygroscopic, and what that means, it absorbs water. And when it absorbs water, it lowers the boiling point, and you may get brake fade. More of that to come a little bit later. You got some vials here. Some look the same, some a little different. What's going on here?
Well, John, right here on number one, ACS fresh, clean brake fluid. Good to go. Number two here, although it looks like number one, it actually has a lot of moisture in it and has to be tested. Very important. And number three here, you know, it looks kind of bad, but doesn't mean it's bad. Once again, you have to test the brake fluid.
And that's the key. We're going to show you in this video why you should change your brake fluid, and more importantly, the test that you can make to determine the condition of the brake fluid. Now, this is pretty cool, but you actually have something even cooler.
Yeah, I'm going to set up a demo and boil some fluid so we can see how that works.
Well, while you do that, let's understand the basics of brake fluid. What is it? Why do we have it? When do we need to change it? Well, first of all, brake fluid is the heart of the system. It's located right here in the reservoir of your master cylinder. And how it works, you actually push on the brake pedal. And when you push on the brake pedal, you're transferring mechanical energy from some pistons inside of the master cylinder here. And what's that doing? It's pressurizing the brake fluid, the hydraulic fluid. Then what it does, it sends it down these lines here. And when it goes down the lines, it's either going to go to a caliper or a wheel cylinder. You can see the caliper assembly right here. Our brake fluid is pushing on the back of a piston, which is engaging these pads right here. And when it engages the pads, it actually squeezes the rotor, and that's what does the stopping. So the brake fluid, once again, is the heart of the system. Over here on a drum brake system, well, the same thing. Our master cylinder is developing the pressure. The brake fluid is then transmitted through the lines and hoses over to a wheel cylinder, where it comes out and engages the shoes. When it engages the shoes, it hits the drum, and it does the stopping. Now, brake fluid comes in all shapes and sizes. We have right here dot 3, dot 4, and dot 5. Dot stands for Department of Transportation. Dot 3 and dot 4 are glycol-based fluids. Dot 5, on the other hand, that's a silicone-based fluid. So you don't want to interchange dot 5 with any glycol fluids, dot 3 or dot 4. There's also a dot 5.1, which is glycol based, but it has a very high boiling point. Now, if your car calls for dot 3, you can use dot 3 or dot 4 because it's a higher boiling point. Dot 4 has a higher boiling point than dot 3. Dot 5 has even a higher boiling point, but it's silicone based. So only use dot 5 on high performance applications or where your service manual calls for dot 5 because it's silicone based. These two are interchangeable. Now you can see the different sizes in the bottles. I told you a little earlier, it's hygroscopic. Well, it absorbs water right out of the atmosphere. So if I take the cap off and I leave the cap off, I'm absorbing water into this brake fluid. What am I doing? Lowering the boiling point. So when you're using brake fluid, a good tip is make sure you get a small container and keep the top on there. Make sure it's secure. If you have a big one, make sure you're going to use it within a year's time. You don't want it absorbing water on the shelf life. And once it does that, it lowers the boiling point and it gets into that condition called brake fade. And Chase is going to demonstrate that with the demo that's actually boiling brake fluid. You can see how it actually reacts to temperature and what's going on when there's some moisture in the system.
All right, we got a cool demo here. What I have here on number one is actually brake fluid with some moisture in it. It's actually bad. It looks good, but it's actually bad. As you can see, it's starting to boil inside there. And that's just what's going to happen to your car when you hit the brakes and your fluid's bad. It's going to cause brake fade and you're not going to stop. And number two here, as you can see, I put in fresh new brake fluid. And now the boiling point's not getting reached because that fluid's in excellent shape and you're going to stop just like you need to.
Man, what are you cooking here? It looks like a science experiment.
Yeah, it's cooking, that's for sure.
It is cooking, and that's the really cool part about it. We said it was hygroscopic. Now, on our truck, we actually took some fluid out. Looks brand new, but you know it's got 100,000 miles in it. There's a ton of moisture in there, and you can see the boiling point actually went down. These are both dot 3 brake fluids. This one, the seal was broken, poured right in from the bottle. I mean, fresh, brand new fluid. The torches are about the same rate. I mean, this is not an exact science, but we've been boiling this for a long time. We can't even get this one to boil. I mean, that's the huge difference. And think about this. Air is compressible and liquid is not. So once we get that air bubbles in that system, remember back on that master cylinder, you push that master cylinder, you can't compress that air, Chase. What's going to happen? That pedal's just going to go right to the floor. Man, you got an unsafe situation, number one. Number two, it's time to check it. And like you said, it looks great, but you know what? we have to test it. In order to test it, you got some awesome test strips.
Yeah, what we have to do is use test strips. And what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna go over to the truck and put them into the brake fluid and actually test our fluid and see what kind of condition we are in. If you look at this, John, it's really boiling now and our other fluid's still looking good.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we'll go ahead over to the truck. We'll test it with some test strips. We'll look at some other methods as well.
We talked about earlier how important it is to test your brake fluid, and that's what we're going to do right here on this truck. And as you can see, I got my test strips here. It's the easiest and quickest way to test your brake fluid. All you want to do is pop the cap open, pull out one of these little strips, and there's a little pad on the end of it that's actually going to absorb the fluid on it. And what we're going to do is going to hold my strip, open my cap, just set it down in the brake fluid, pull it back out. And usually takes about 60 seconds or so, but as you can see, it already changed into a dark purple here. And it's at the required service. It's got 200 parts per million of copper inside of them. That's not good. And there's another test you can do. You can actually use your refractometer and check the specific gravity. The most important thing is to check your fluid.
Yeah, no matter how good it looks. Let me see that strip there. No matter how good it looks, you can actually see it right there. That purple color is actually showing us copper. And I know what you're thinking. Brake lines aren't made out of copper. Where's the copper coming from? Well, there's a copper alloy and there's different nickel metal alloys in the lines. And when the brake fluid deteriorates, the additives go away. And when the additives go away, the copper becomes corrosive and starts eating up the lines. And what happens, it gets into the brake fluid. So this is a really good measurement of what's going on with the brake fluid. Now, on the other hand, we talked about the specific gravity, the weight, the actual water in there content in the brake fluid. That's gonna make a huge difference. And if you look at this graphic right here, this actually shows what's going on because there's a coefficient of friction. Now think about coefficient of friction as two surfaces rubbed together. If I took ice cube and I went across a table, well, that would slide real easy. That's not a high coefficient of friction. But if I took sandpaper and I went across the table, that would be a high coefficient of friction. It would be hard to push across. Well, we want a high coefficient of friction between the pads and the rotors, and you can see it right here. And what happens is as the brake fluid starts to heat up, I got 175 to 200 degrees Celsius, that's about 400 degrees Fahrenheit. So what happens, you can see it's actually dropping off, and when it drops off, you get what's called fading. Once again, just like you saw, we're boiling that fluid. When we boil that fluid, air gets introduced, it's compressible, liquid's not, pedals go into the floor, unsafe situation. Also, brake fluids, one other thing I want to share with you is not only is it hygroscopic, it also eats paint. Because it's hygroscopic, it absorbs water. If you put some water on the paint, don't wipe it, that'll neutralize it. So if you get any on the paint, that's also a good idea. Now, what does it do? Let's take a look at the seals inside of an ABS unit and a master cylinder so you can see what's going on when you don't change the brake fluid. Now you understand the importance of why you should change the brake fluid. You also understand about the specific gravity and the weight of the brake fluid and the hygroscopic portions of it that causes brake fade. Let's look at contamination. That's a whole nother issue. How do you contaminate brake fluid? Anything in the system but brake fluid. If you put any mineral spirit based, it's going to swell up the seals and it's going to cause damage. And I have some good illustrations right here. The first one here is an actual master cylinder. And you can look inside the master cylinder. There's a primary and a secondary piston in there. But the important part are these seals. These seals is what holds the pressure in the high pressure chamber. Any kind of contamination, you can see it right here. It's gonna blow out these seals, actually start to deteriorate them, and they're gonna fall apart. And what's gonna happen is the fluid is gonna bleed from one chamber to the other. And when it does that, that pedal starts going slowly to that floor, that sinking feeling that you don't want. Now on our wheel cylinder right here, same thing. Our wheel cylinder assembly has some steel parts in there, actually has a spring expander and an actual piston here. But the key here is the cup right here located that goes on the piston. Once again, another lip seal. Once it deteriorates, it starts to expand contamination. That brake fluid, you saw the strip with the copper in there, it's going to cause deterioration. It's going to start to leak. Your wheel cylinder's not going to work. Now I have a caliper assembly as well. Once again, a lot of steel parts. You think it wouldn't be a problem. Well, the key here is the square cut seal. Now the square cut seal is located right here. The fluid goes behind the piston and it rides here and it pushes out on the piston. We talked about that hydraulic pressure when we first started. Well, this square cut seal is the only thing that's keeping that fluid inside this caliper assembly. It's also retracting the caliper once it comes out. So what happens to that piston is as it pushes out, this seal deforms a little bit and it has to hold the fluid. Well, contamination, once again, think about it. I get all that fluid in there, it starts to rot that seal and eat. Not only am I going to have leakage, it's never going to hold the pressure to actually push the caliper out. Now, last but really the most important is this anti-lock braking systems. Cars today are all equipped with anti-lock braking systems. And what's the importance of that? Well, once again, the fluid. The fluid has to be clean. The fluid has to be right. Why? Well, you can see right here, the pistons. Well, just multiply that piston by 3, 4, maybe 10, all the nooks and crannies and O-rings inside this unit here that has to function properly, and it can only function properly with clean brake fluid. So another tip for you, if you're gonna disassemble any one of these components and you're gonna rebuild any of them, use denatured alcohol or clean brake fluid. Never use any other product to do that, or you're gonna contaminate the seals. But this ABS should be the icing on the cake. Chase, we got a problem with our Silverado.
Yeah, we gotta get to it, and we gotta change out our brake fluid.
Well, we need to get to work.